All right, welcome back, everyone. I hope you're having an amazing time. Our next session is titled AI-Powered Retail Supply Chains. Please join me in welcoming our panelists to the virtual stage.
Welcome, attendees, and welcome, panelists. Thank you so much for being here. I know we're all very excited to jump right into it, so looks like everyone has joined. And without any further ado, we're going to kick it off with self-introduction. So we're going to begin with Karthik. If you could please introduce yourself and your role so that the audience can get to know you. Karthik, take it away.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Karthik Mahadevan. I'm Senior Director of Product Management in Lowe's, supply chain tech, responsible for all the tech products that we build around demand forecasting, inventory replenishment, customer promise, purchase order management, and a host of others. Excited to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for being here, Karthik. Harish, you want to introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, thanks, Daniel. Hey, everyone. I'm Harish Srigiraju. I'm a principal engineer at Verizon. I lead a lot of efforts on machine learning analytics for one of the consumer cloud products at Verizon. And I also work closely on the innovation side where I come up with new product ideas, including IoT devices and so on. So excited to be here and speak with you all. Thank you for the opportunity.
Excellent. Thank you, Harish. And Vinay, you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hey, folks. My name is Vinay Narayana. I run machine learning engineering at Wayfair for a few of the data science product groups. There are four product groups overall that I provide ML engineering services for. One is obviously supply chain. Second one is business to business. The third one is voice of customer and transformations. The fourth one is the payments and fraud. So my team is responsible for the data engineering, the feature engineering, all the MLOps work, productionizing the models, as well as going on call for supporting some of our critical models in production 24/7. Prior to this role, I ran big data engineering, which included managing our Kafka, Hadoop, as well as a data movement platform I helped build at Wayfair. So thanks for having me here. Super excited and looking forward to exciting panel.
Thank you, Vinay. And Julian, would you like to finish us off here with a self-introduction?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everybody. My name is Julian Biou. I'm the CEO of Scale AI. So Scale AI is quite of a different beast here around the table because we are a global innovation hub funded by the government of Canada. And our role is to subsidize AI introduction into the supply chain industry and into any company for their supply chain activity. So we had a fair amount of our projects in retail. And so we can bring an interesting perspective about how AI would be introduced in retail. We had funded 70 projects, invested $150 million in 3 years. So happy to be here in this panel to bring the expertise we have brought to Canada.
All right. Thank you so much, Julian. All right. We're going to jump into the next question without any further ado, because we got a lot to get through. All right. So, and Karthik, I'm hoping you can kick us off here. So I think there's a lot of confusion around who's using AI. They want to know about the state of adoption in the industry. So the question is, supply chain is an area receiving a lot of attention for its potential for AI innovation. Exactly how much AI is currently involved today in supply chains? And again, Karthik, if you'd be so kind as to share your thoughts initially.
Yeah. So, you know, supply chain is vast, right? So there are so many different areas within supply chain. Think about inventory management, think about replenishment, think about forecasting demand, think about transportation, getting stuff from point A to point B, getting stuff from the vendors into distribution centers. So this is a enormous amount of work that's going on in supply chain. And we use the term supply chain a little loosely sometimes, right? I mean, it's composed of so many different buckets almost of work that goes on. So some of the big areas where I think AI is being used and is coming up a lot, one is in forecasting demand. How do you know what to carry in your stores? How much of it should you carry? Where should you carry them, right? So a lot of the big players are global in many cases. Within the US, they have multiple stores, thousands of stores. How much of it should you carry? What should you carry? Where should you carry? and what should you carry, right? So a lot of this is forecasting, making sure that we are planning for the future. AI plays a pretty big role over here. There is a lot of AI also in inventory management, right? So if you think about how to fulfill orders, we want to get an order from the time it's placed to the time it reaches the customer as quickly as possible, means inventory has to be in the right place also. So if somebody is ordering, as an example, somebody is ordering, drills in Florida, and the drills are all located in a warehouse in Montana, it's going to take us a long time to get it from Montana to Florida, right? So you should be carrying drills in Florida, as an example. I'm taking a very, very simple example just to make it clear, but how much of it should you be carrying? Where should you be carrying, and projecting that and planning for that? There's a lot of forecasting that goes into that as well. So both in terms of inventory management, in terms of demand forecasting, are two big areas that I can think of that come to mind immediately. Transportation is another big area, but those are some of the big areas, I think. I'll pause here. Very, very talented panel here. I'll invite others to speak as well.
Do you want me to go, Dan?
Yeah, feel free to chime in at any time, anyone, please.
Yeah, so in my opinion, predicting customer demand is highly challenging. Not to speak of geopolitical, the pandemic and Suez Canal blockage, all of these are external factors that you have no control over as a result, and that also directly impacts our supply chain. So as Karthik rightly pointed out, it's a very vast space and there are numerous challenges. I think several companies are trying to crack the code, if you will, for bringing AI and automating all the manual operations that thousands of people at a e-commerce company would be doing, right? So it's very expensive. To me, the nirvana state for supply chain is really having the products in the right place at the right time and in right quantity. Getting there, I think, is extremely, extremely hard. And I don't believe any company has cracked the code for having everything, end-to-end figured out with machine learning as it relates to supply chain. And also, I believe there is probably scope for a lot of innovation in this space. As a result, from what I have seen and what I know about companies, there are a lot of people trying to get machine learning into the supply chain space, but we are barely scratching the surface, I believe, in what could potentially be solved over the next several years, especially with some of the recent data science advancements that the industry has been making.
Just to add to some of the other panel members here said, I think supply chain, first of all, is like a huge area, right? Like there are so many sub divisions to it, which Karthik alluded to. So one, like definitely there are a lot of like models being deployed here, but fundamentally the way I see it is like supply chain constitutes of a lot of like engineering problems, like optimization problems, where there are so many trade-offs between like price, cost, time, and so on. So because you have all these like optimization problems, and I think that's why machines come into picture and they do a better job with these kind of like complex trade-offs, which like humans sometimes are not capable of. So that's why I think optimization becomes the core of like a lot of these supply chain issues. And hence like machine learning models are more and more deployed there. And we see that increasingly. I think it's already alluded to, like demand forecasting is the primary one because it affects like costs or time and so on, right? So, but like, I think that's like the paramount one. And especially now, a lot of companies are facing supply chain issues because it's become more global in nature. But fundamentally, that's demand forecasting becomes like the key thing. But beyond that, there are so many other things like quality control, like transportation, fuel shortage, and so on. So there are a lot of other components. But yeah, like I just wanted to highlight the optimization problem with which AIs are very good. AI will be a good way to solve these.
Yeah, and There's of course a good reason why AI, everybody thinking about AI in supply chain, because you can have a lot of data in theory in supply chain, so it's good to apply AI. But that's also where the trick is first of all, you have to have data available, and that's not all companies that have data available. And one of the issues also you face when introducing AI into supply chain is, and that's why demand forecasting is so popular right now, because demand forecasting is just yourself, meaning it's your own data and you don't rely on vendors or data suppliers. So basically AI introduction in retail really began, is really beginning in what you control as a retailer, which is basically demand, possible stock optimization, warehouse optimization. But the critical thing obviously in supply chain is how to interconnect supply chains and how to share data so you can have interconnected supply chains and apply AI to this interconnected data. And that's much more complex. So it's true that AI has a lot of potential in the supply chain industry. It's also true that, and I totally agree with the other three panelists, is we are really barely scratching the surface because companies are right now introducing AI, what they can control, the data they can control, but there's much more potential if people are able to share data and to work in interconnected supply chains.
Excellent. Thank you all for sharing. So just to jump to the next topic, and I think someone mentioned that demand forecasting was one of these opportunities that maybe was one of the most obvious and potentially easy areas to, you know, begin to focus on initially. This question appears about where the value is found, but I'm curious if we can all agree on, is there a particular area where it makes a lot of sense to start, you know, as an organization that's trying to innovate in supply chains when it comes to AI? And actually, Julian, I'm curious if you would kick us off here because you see so many organizations working on this stuff. Is there an area that's kind of obvious to begin?
Well, definitely. As I said, it's very important to begin where you can control your data, when you have data available, because if you don't have data, that's no way doing AI. So usually where you control data is typically, or at least when you can have something immediately available, is demand forecasting. And that's very key because if you optimize demand, then you can much better optimize your supply chain. And that's the drill example between Montana and Florida. If you know people in Florida needs drill, then obviously it's easy to ship them before they are really asked for them. So demand forecasting is absolutely key. But it's fair to say also some other companies are also working what's happening in point of sales. So typically a demand transference. So they don't have a product, what kind of product it could have. Are working also on a lot of staff optimization, meaning the same, because with demand forecasting, you have issues, of course, on products, but also on staff to be able to ask and to answer the demand. And of course, in inventory management and a warehouse optimization, because that's all companies have under their own control. They control the data, they can have inputs, they can control. Obviously, there's much more potential, as I said, but I think if you were to begin as a company in introducing AI in your organization, I would strongly recommend you do that in areas where you own the data, when you have data first, and when you own data and you can control it.
What does everyone else say? Agree, disagree, think that something else could be mentioned in this conversation?
Yeah, I would agree with him. The other area where I feel, we are making some progress with AI in supply chain is with customer promise. You know, all these delivery dates that you see on any of these e-commerce websites, in some cases they are using machine learning in the backend to do that, right? So it provides a lot of value for users, in my opinion, especially, you know, if you have two products that two vendors on the internet are providing, one of the differentiating factors would be, assuming everything else is the same, the delivery date. If somebody can deliver the product for you in a couple of days versus 2 weeks, it's an easy decision for the user, right? So there's a lot of competition. And hence, I believe this results in positive revenue for the company as well. So there's a lot of potential with respect to solving the delivery date problem. And it's not easy either, because there are all these other things that you have to worry about, exceptions, you know, when there's a blizzard in the Northeast or a tornado somewhere in the South, right? So these sort of things make it hard. But I believe that's a good entry point, I believe, for companies that are looking to leverage AI.
Or a snowstorm in Montreal, Julian.
Right, that too.
I just wanted to add to what Julian mentioned. So the AI is only as good as the data, right? So think of, like, for companies starting off, like, I think it's always an evolution towards like AI, etc. So the first thing is like understanding like what are the devices, like intelligent devices, IoT sensors, and so on. Like these are the ones that are generating data. So really thinking about like what kind of devices do they exist currently in your supply chain, and see what data you're collecting. So that becomes key. And I just wanted to also highlight that, you know, with 5G technology, the number of like IoT devices is expected to like significantly exponentially grow. So this becomes like a key thing for companies to look at, like, what are the IoT devices? How can you think about like data from each of these devices and what applications are being run of these devices? And just to add to that, like, I think there's also the intelligent edge component to it. Like, you want to like immediately process some of this data on the manufacturing floor without actually having to do like cloud computing and so on. So to summarize, I think like IoT devices becomes a key component because these are the ones that are constantly generating useful data.
Perfect. I was going to ask you. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I was just going to, you know, I wanted to tie back to what Vinay was saying. You know, customer promise is an area which is a very, in supply chain, differentiates, you know, one company from the other. There are a lot of companies that don't have a solid customer promise solution in place. And the ones that do have a customer promise, right? So when we say customer promise, basically, you know, how long does it take for an item to get from the warehouse or the store to the customer, right? How long are we promising? There are companies that promise 2 weeks. There are companies that promise 2 days. And typically the ones that promise it in 2 days are the ones that are going to get the business. So now if you extend that use case and you think about why is this important now as opposed to, you know, maybe 2 years ago, I think COVID has changed a lot of things. Right now, customer behavior has shifted online. Omni has become a true, it's not just a buzzword anymore. It's a true challenge that a lot of companies that were not born on the cloud are now trying to solve for. And when you've got new use cases that have previously not been solved by a lot of the old established companies, now you start to see technologies like AI and ML come in. They can fill the gap very quickly. And allow these companies to leapfrog, right? And there are lots of use cases even within fulfillment. You know, BOPUS as an example. So buy online, pick up in store. What should I carry in the store for a BOPUS customer, right? I never used to think about that before, right? I was always carrying stuff in the store that I was expecting somebody to walk into the store and buy. But now I have to think about this new demographic, which is a customer that buys the same thing online, but comes into the store to buy, you know, pick it up. And so is his or her behavior different? How do I predict it? How do I track it? And how does my inventory that I have to carry different from what I used to carry before? Right? So those are the kinds of use cases. Those are the kinds of problems that are now emerged post-COVID that we have to pay a lot of attention to and we have to solve for.
One thing I would love to ask each of you is, you know, Karthi, you talked about, you know, the company A that says 2 weeks, you know, and the other company that says 2 days. I mean, I would love to hear all of your perspective on exactly, is it definitely mandatory that via AI we innovate to increase delivery time, or is it not necessarily critical and, you know, there's X, Y, Z reasons why? I mean, when it comes to competitive advantage and the consumer value you're adding, what matters here, I guess, is my thought. Vinay, what are your thoughts on that?
You're asking what would add value to the user from the perspective of the delivery dates?
Really, what I'm asking is it always absolutely necessary to use machine learning to increase something like delivery time, or is it not necessarily critical for every business in the retail space?
Got it. So, you know, if there was no machine learning making these predictions, companies try to use deterministic services, which are based on some formulae, you know, archaic formulae. They might probably work okay in some cases, but in most cases, it's extremely hard to get it to work. And like I said, when there are exceptions, like a blizzard or a snowfall in Montreal, like you said, a tornado and things like that, right? So that will shut down suppliers, that will shut down warehouses, and that will impact these deterministic services because they cannot model that behavior into the code. That's where, you know, machine learning plays a pretty big role in kind of taking some of these external influences as well and predict the date a little bit better than what a deterministic service can do today. So if companies are not doing that today, then, you know, obviously they're going to be behind compared to the companies that are predicting dates based on machine learning, because they will likely be far more aggressive. Machine learning will be more aggressive in predicting a delivery date compared to a deterministic service. I know several companies that add paddings just to make sure, you know, the customer satisfaction of having the product delivered sooner is greater than, you know, the customer satisfaction with the product delivering late. So as a result, these deterministic services are inherently built with a lot of padding in them, which again, is not good for the company.
And I'll just expand on that just a second, for 1 second, right? So, you know, said another way, in pragmatic terms, what this translates to is probably an army of analysts sitting with an Excel spreadsheet, forecasting, you know, what the dates would be and what we need to carry. So that just basically adds a lot of cost to the company, right? So all the everything that Vinay said boils down to essentially this is what happens in a company where you don't have these kinds of automated systems and machines taking decisions.
I had another point to add in terms of, you know, processes, right? Like before the age of like machine learning AI, like companies have like actually managed supply chain operations, etc. And I think they focus heavily on like process driven supply chain. So to actually like, let's say, smoothen out like the cost, for example, or ensure that there's like a timely delivery. So what I'm saying is like before the age of machine learning, processes were the key, I would say, for big companies to manage their supply chain, manufacturing, and so on. But now I think with the increasing number of variables that go into these processes, you're no longer able to like actually define process for each and every task. So it becomes like more and more complex, because let's say earlier I was just getting like, I have one supplier in a geography close by, but now I have like 10 suppliers across the world. So I think now you can't rely on processes anymore to like actually drive this supply chain, and hence like AI becomes like paramount. So you have companies moving from processes to like AI, I would say.
Yeah, what I would add on that is, I mean, in a normal world, I would totally agree with what's said today. In a world like the one we live on, is shortages, predicting shortages also absolutely key. So it's nice to accelerate the time to delivery. It's also nice to have the products actually to deliver. And I don't know, I'm less familiar with the US market, but in Canada, it's quite of an issue for most retailers. So I would say that one of the focus today of retailers and for the governments, in fairness, is really how to protect critical supply chains to avoid shortages. And if you cannot avoid shortages on one specific item, what kind of demand transference you have for another item? And I mean, what we see today in Canada in terms of projects is really projects about strengthening critical supply chains to be sure that to avoid shortages, or at least to have replacement products in case traditional suppliers would not be able to deliver. So I would say it's we're a little bit living in the supply chain industry in an abnormal world, with everything happening, COVID, and of course the Ukraine war. So it seems that some of the company's priorities have shifted to just survival is a big world, but that is securing critical products and critical products to deliver.
But you know, I do want to say though, you know, one thing, Daniel, to your question of, is it absolutely imperative that we have machine learning? No, I mean, you know, companies existed before machine learning, companies will continue to exist after machine learning. It's not imperative. I do think that when done properly and for the right use cases, machine learning is going to give those companies a huge benefit and an advantage over the others.
It's interesting what you say, because in the projects we fund, and Montreal is very strong on this place, is not only machine learning, it's also what we call operation research that we put under the umbrella of artificial intelligence. And actually what we see is really most of the projects are really the combination between machine learning on one side and operational research on the other side.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are companies like Evado Labs or others, consulting companies, that really are able to merge with the scientists at a very high level of these two technologies. And I think that's, to your point, that's much more successful than pure machine learning approach.
Absolutely. Customer promise is an area where ops research is critical, right? I mean, at the end of the day, there's a tremendous amount of math going on to optimize the correct location, to identify the place from where you can source the item from. to get it to the customer as quickly as possible falls squarely within the domain of ops research. And when you pair that with machine learning, then you know you can be really, really powerful.
Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to add another point with the computer vision specifically, like, you know, that actually is adding a lot of value. Like you can actually, in the manufacturing floor, you can detect like defects, for example, and things like that. So that's another area I feel like, you know, you can deploy these like computer vision at scale. So apart from the optimization problem, there's also these like new age models that can be actually deployed to get a lot of value. And these things, I feel you can't do without machine learning. You can do like optimization problem with mathematical models, operational research, but the computer vision, the benefits you obtain from it, maybe those are not possible without machine learning.
Yeah, thank you for pointing that out, Harish. Patrika, if it's okay, I'd love to jump into the next question if you can find it. Okay, great. So what challenges exist when it comes to using AI for supply chains? Obviously, everyone listening to this is probably excited right now about all the opportunity, but there definitely are challenges. Julian, I was curious if you would take a first stab at this because you see so many different organizations working at this. You know, what challenges do you see most frequently?
So obviously, data availability is a key one. That's quite obvious. As I said, you need to have data to do AI. I would say in second, and that's perhaps more on perhaps more common to the Canadian market. I don't know in the US, but the availability of resources. And because we have funded actually a fair amount of projects that could not get through because people were not able to find data scientists, data engineers, not even talking about AI specialists. So the real critical bottleneck for most of the projects right now is not funding by itself. It's really the availability of technical resources. Well, technical is a broad sense. For companies to be able, and actually it's a critical issue for companies externally and internally. So they are not able to find the right people internally, most of the case, to manage the project, and they are not able to find enough resources externally to help them manage. So I would say as of today, one of the critical impediments around, of course, data availability is really the way we see it, resources, human resources on tech broadly and AI specifically.
Excellent. Anyone else want to jump in?
Yeah, I would agree with Julian. I was going to make the exact so two comments that he did. One is, you know, data availability, obviously, but available data doesn't mean it's accurate either, right? So the data needs to be reliable. The people who are producing data have to treat their data as a product. I can point out there are so many companies, including the large tech ones that you can imagine, they all struggle with this. There are producers of data some sitting somewhere, right, close to the website. And there are people, especially the data scientists, that are at the far end trying to consume this data. A lot happens between these two systems. As a result, the data before, by the time it ends up in a data warehouse or a data store, it's you know, completely different and keeps changing, right? So in addition to making the data available, I think most companies these days, with some of these advancements we have done with data engineering, et cetera, they are able to bring some data into a data warehouse that data scientists could use. However, there's a huge struggle to get reliable data, accurate data into these data stores. The other aspect which Julian touched on is hiring, right? So especially in the supply chain space, you know, there are some recent advancements made with respect to reinforcement learning, you know, transformers, embeddings, et cetera, which will be very useful in the supply chain space. But these are advanced techniques. Many companies, even if they want to hire some of these experienced data scientists, they can't because they don't exist. You know, there's so much competition for hiring these data scientists across the various tech companies these days. So hiring is a huge, huge challenge, in my opinion.
So there are two challenges that I see currently that exist. From a business perspective, I would say, what is the problem that one is trying to solve for? Because there's so many problems that on a day-to-day basis you want to maybe solve for. But like first is like really understanding, prioritizing. First is like, what is the question that you're trying to answer or what is the problem that you're trying to solve? I feel like that's the key challenge from a business perspective. And ability to like prioritize, et cetera, to have like a most bang for the buck. So that's on the business side. The second challenge, I think stating the obvious here, but just emphasizing again, is the quality of data. That's like the biggest pet peeve and, like, you know, always an issue when I'm working on like machine learning models or analytics. There is data available. It's like in different sources of the world, or maybe different data centers or things like that. So I think one, data is spread out, like it's distributed in some way. And second, the quality of data is sometimes like poor. There's not like enough auditing of data, like how you have like for security. I feel like there should be like more auditing of data, data labeling and things like that. So from a technical perspective, the quality of data, from a business perspective, what is the problem that you're trying to solve for? I think these things need to be drilled down before we actually like gain benefits.
And I have, you know, I agree with, you know, everything that they're saying. There's one additional problem, which is, you know, just because we built a model doesn't mean it's going to get adopted, right? Again, depends on the type of the company and all of that. But anytime you're introducing something new, there's a fair amount of change management involved. You've got businesses that are used to doing things in a certain way, and now you're introducing a completely different way, and you're asking them to believe something that was generated by a machine. Why should I believe it? You know, and how do you, and I'm, you want me to bet my company on this? You want me to, you know, believe that this machine's forecasts are going to be better than mine? Why should I believe it? Right. So there's a change management aspect. There is a maturity curve over here that a lot of companies have to cross. And you go from being a science experiment to a fully productionized scalable solution. Those are two completely different things. A lot of machine learning projects die as science experiments. To get them to production and use them in production is completely different. And so that's, in my mind, you know, after you cross the data challenge, that's the biggest problem.
Right. I also had another challenge in mind, which is sometimes when you deploy these models, you get these recommendations or outcomes, but sometimes without like really understanding the input or the model, you don't know why that recommendation was given. I think without understanding the why, sometimes decision making becomes hard, and hence like sometimes you have to rely on like qualitative data, really trying to like drill down. So that's another challenge that I have faced, where you get a recommendation, but you don't know why it is recommending. The system has crunched a lot of data. So that's another challenge in my mind.
Maybe I'll add one more based on what I'm hearing from what others say. You know, many companies out there struggle with having a proper ML system. What I mean by that is a platform that data scientists can leverage, where data is reliable, you know, they have an ability to ability to serve the models either in online or batch mode, have a platform for training, you know, have continuous monitoring, having a system that is easy to use. You know, scientists are not engineers. And that's the reason, you know, people like me and my team exist to help with that. But not every company or not every data science team is fortunate enough to have engineers embedded with them, right? So not having a ML system that can help scientists build these models effectively and efficiently is also a big problem. You know, the public clouds are solving some of these. You know, Google has Vertex AI, AWS has SageMaker. I'm sure Azure also has something, I just don't know. The point is, the public clouds are trying to solve some of these problems, but may not be a solution for some of these on-prem companies, right? Or even people who don't like to use the cloud. So these are all perhaps another challenge, may not be specifically related to supply chain, but if you want to innovate, you want to have a very stable and reliable platform.
So this has been fantastic. My question, my follow-up question, I think it would be too ambitious to address each of these challenges. But the question is there any, for the audience listening, you know, is there any way that you approach one of these challenges? I'd love to, you know, and I'm going to list them back out to you. So first challenge is data availability, cleaning it, using it, getting it from the right place. Number two is hiring. Number three is prioritization of different projects, change management and trust in AI models. Also related, black boxes and a lack of interpretability. And then finally, ease of use. Does anyone want to talk about how they think about addressing any of these, just potentially?
In my opinion, one of the things that would accelerate a company's ability to productionize their models is to have a solid ML system that scientists can use. I think data is a pretty large problem. The bigger the size of the company, the larger the data problem. And it will probably take years for a typical company, typical large company, I would say, to solve it. So that is probably where I go, right? So give acceleration to data scientists where you can give them an easy way to productionize their models, you know, at least give them capabilities where they can, build and evaluate models in a very easy manner and try to fix as much of the data issues as you can through monitoring, et cetera. So that's my thought.
I can speak on the prioritization aspect of it. So the way I see it is, you know, you have to have like clear assumptions or hypothesis built out. Like, you know, it's easy to have an opinion. Everyone has an opinion in the team. So I think it's very helpful to have like a hypothesis in mind. And then what is the easiest way to like really maybe use machine learning or other models to actually validate or negate the hypothesis? So if you think about like everything in business can be like a hypothesis and then testing or validating that hypothesis, I think that's like a good way or an approach to solve the prioritization problem, apart from the usual in terms of like what is the impact versus effort and the impact. So those kind of the obvious ones you can look at for prioritization, but the hypothesis testing is super helpful when deploying models.
You know, your question was very interesting because that's typically the type of question we ask to projects before funding them. So I don't know how they do it, but that's the question we ask. And usually there are some of the answers we get or some of the requests we have to projects is, first of all, try to do what we call a blueprint. And a blueprint is really a place where, or a document actually, where first of all, business needs are very well expressed and summarized, because at the end of the day, there's no good AI project if the business needs are not clear and very well thought. In the blueprint, you look at data availability and data cleanness and everything around, and you know, and you look at existing solutions, existing AI software, because it's fair to say that in some cases, the software you would use is still at research stage and not at all as you were saying in a production stage. So, I mean, that's what we try to ask companies to provide us is kind of blueprint targeting these questions to be sure at least they raise the question internally and they have answers on that. So that's for sure is a good request. The second one, and coming back to Katrick's point, is really about training. And we highly recommend companies to do some training before the project and after the project. And typically change management is something that we really encourage companies to do. And basically we fund normally 40 to 50% of the cost of implementation of the AI and creation of the AI model, but we also fund 50% of the training, typically in change management, to be sure that companies really spend that money to really improve the quality of the project. So I don't have miracle, but that's typically the type of questions we have. And then going to some steps that is to answer is really providing more comfort on our side to really fund a project and to have a successful project at the end.
Yeah, and you know, my experience has been that the models play a part in the total solution, in the overall solution, right? So the solution that a company is building is solving a problem to Harish's point, right? And the model is one way to solve that problem. And there are lots of other factors involved in building out that solution, right? You've got to have a very convincing user experience. The ability to catch exceptions in a forecasting system, depending on the granularity of the data that you have, you might have a lot of exceptions that you might want to catch and manage. Are you providing a good experience to the end users as they do that? The model is just, you know, one engine, one of the different parts that make up the overall solution, right? So thinking about that solution overall in a very holistic manner, keeping in mind the problem that we're really trying to solve, I think is key. That will also help in change management and user adoption. And change management goes back to making sure that it's trustable, it's trustworthy, it's believable, whatever the model is spitting out is, you know, smells right, you know, looks right. And if not, then is there a way for you to catch those exceptions? And you know, suggest and is there a feedback loop back to the model? You know, all those things I think play a part in the overall solution. And at the end of the day, what is success, right? Success is not spitting out the model. Success is adoption of the solution by the user and solving that problem. So a lot of aspects to this, I think, Daniel, this alone is probably a topic for the next you know, meeting that you've got. This alone is huge.
Yeah, I know. There's no way we can cover all of it, but thank you so much, Karthik. Now, I want to jump into that one more question before we do our last one. And Vinay, I know you had a particular interest in this based on some of the challenges that you've seen. The question I wanted to ask you is, how do you ensure the high quality of machine learning models that are powering, you know, critical functions in the supply chain? Because I know you wanted to talk about this. You've seen some challenges in this area. What are your thoughts here?
Yeah, so if you take customer promise as a good example that we discussed quite a bit earlier, predicting those delivery dates is no trivial problem. At any typical time on a large e-commerce website, there are potentially millions of users looking at millions of products at the same time. And everybody lives in different part of the world, and you have to predict a date, right? So whatever model and the service that you build should have the ability to process these thousands of requests that might come in every second, take into account the various environmental things and predict make a prediction on the delivery date, right? So that's no trivial manner. So you really have to build you know, high throughput, low latency services that are capable of responding back in real time to the website with a delivery date prediction. Doing that takes a lot of energy from the perspective of building highly scalable ML service that wraps around the model, having very, very low latencies, right? We are talking about 10 milliseconds probably at P95. So these are all things that are not easy for many companies to do, but something, you know, something that needs to be built out for some of these critical functions. Same goes with any other aspects where you have this real-time serving. You know, you need to have the engineering chops to be able to build a highly distributed, scalable system.
Definitely. Thank you so much. Would anyone else want to just comment on this topic, you know, having to do with ensuring the highest quality ML product to make sure that critical functions remain working correctly?
Yeah, I can add to that. I think I wanted to echo what Karthik mentioned earlier. The feedback loop is like very critical, generally in like operations or even in machine learning. I feel a lot of times, like, you know, companies or teams are thinking about like deploying models as like a one-time effort, but it's like actually requires a lot of tweaking, lot of like feedback loop. That is the most critical part of it. The second part is like, you know, sometimes I've seen, we try to like label data, but you know, you don't know the quality of the machine learning deployed there. And so how do you test the quality of data? How do you test the quality of labeling? Is there like manual intervention? Is a machine labeling the data as well? So those are like complex issues. And I feel you need like more auditing, more solutions that can actually, on top of machine learning, see how, what is the performance of the model deployed as well. So I think these are the two things I would say. One is the feedback loop, and second, like more auditing or manual intervention to actually test these machine learning models that are deployed.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. And if you're able to give the users, you know, overrides for certain, you know, forecasts as an example, if you're able to provide a mechanism by which they can send information back to the model, so the model is continuously getting trained as well, right? So, you know, that will ensure a high quality output all the time. And many times it takes a while before, even in production, even though it might have been trained a lot, even in production, I think ensuring a high quality from the day one is going to be a little bit challenging. So it has, you have to give it time to evolve and learn.
Excellent.
No, just to say that what you are describing, it's typically the challenge for the ecosystem. If you think about the AI ecosystem right now, whether in the US, in Canada, and is to make the link between university and fundamental research and operations. And that's a very critical question because you have a lot of software available in researchers' mind, but even if they are available, actually to introduce them in real operation, in real company, with, as Vinay was describing, a real operational system, that's a totally different story. And so that's much of a challenge actually for the industry, is taking this software that are existing right now in universities and research facilities and find the right structure to bring them home, in a sense, operationally, with something robust and which is not and reliable. So, I mean, that's a global challenge we face typically in building this type of AI ecosystem.
Excellent.
Okay, if I add one more point?
Of course, Vinay.
Yeah, so one other thing that I could think of while I was hearing the other panelists talk about some of these things, continuous integration, continuous delivery, continuous deployment, and continuous training, right? So these are pretty complicated, especially the continuous deployment part and continuous training part. I call this a ML factory, where you bring a model, and then once it goes into this ML factory, where you are doing automated integration tests, delivery and deployment and training, right? So training also could be performed automatically if you have some continuous monitoring as well, which is monitoring both for data quality as well as the model drift. If either of these touches a threshold or exceeds a threshold, we want to be able to trigger a automated training pipeline. So the model gets automatically gets trained, and then it goes through these, the tests, numerous tests we're going to have for delivery and deployment, and it goes into production automatically. You know, having this loop having these models train themselves and go into production will ensure very high quality for companies. By the way, this is easy to say, very hard to implement, right? So we need to acknowledge that as well.
Yeah, I was just going to say this is like utopia, right? I mean,
yeah.
This is hard to achieve, but this is the goal that we should all strive towards.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. That's like the Nirvana state for a ML system for any solving any ML problem.
Yeah. Yeah. It's hard enough to get CI/CD developed even for non-ML applications. So,
right.
You know, where there's no training and all that, and your customers might not even want to see, continuous deployment, right? Just leave the application alone is what they might even say. So, a lot of challenges to getting there, but I do agree. I mean, this is Nirvana.
Yeah. Software development has been around for a very, very long time, right? And we have good processes on how to do CI/CD. In machine learning, we have the complexity of a model of data and this training. All these things make it far more complicated. I think there's a lot of innovation to be made in this space, and that's the reason it is so exciting to be working in this area.
Well, we are just about out of time. Anyone want to say a final thought about the panel, the topic, maybe what is going to push us in the right direction, considering, the last comments that you all just made?
I mean, I thought it was a very interesting panel from my own perspective. It was very interesting to hear people in the operations really describing how AI could be really used to do that. I mean, there's a tremendous impact potentially for AI in the supply chain globally and in retail specifically. But it's really the very, very early days, with like years and years and years before achieving just a small part of this impact. Meaning the comparison I used to take is we are in the AI world today, where internet was in 1995, and building a website in 1995 was a totally different story than it is now. And so AI will evolve and basically will be much more mature in 10, 15 years from now. And that's where perhaps everybody will take advantage of AI in the supply chain and retail. But between that time, there's a lot to do and a lot of progress to make. And I'm very impressed by what the three organizations are doing right now, and the other people in the panel are doing right now to introduce real AI to the operations.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the panel. I think this was an awesome discussion. One thing I want to say we didn't get a chance to talk a lot about is AutoML. AutoML has a lot of potential, a few years from now. And for smaller companies that cannot afford data scientists, AutoML could be a great technology to leverage for solving some of these massive problems with either customer promise or demand forecasting, et cetera. I believe there's a lot of potential there.
My final comment would be about like what Julian mentioned earlier about like having a blueprint ready and proactively developing this blueprint, which is what is the problem that you're trying to solve? What is the data that is available or you need to like start collecting, and what is the model? So I think having like such a blueprint early on and then using that blueprint to like course correct constantly is what you should be doing in terms of deploying these AI models in supply chain.
Yeah, you know, I want to again echo, this is a great panel. One of the interesting challenges or problems that a lot of companies are trying to solve now is AI and ML at the intersection of merchandising and supply chain. So when you think about supply chain, by itself is pretty huge. When you tack on merchandising, and they are kind of very interconnected and intertwined, right? So can you get localized inventory for the market, and how do you get that through an optimized supply chain? Now you are getting into customized orders, and it's more applicable in certain areas, you know, more than others. But this is an area that might be even worth pursuing and thinking more about. This is one of those things where, you know, unlimited potential.
Amazing. And with that, we are about out of time. Patrika, are you still with us today?
Of course, I'm right here listening to this amazing panel. Thank you so much for all of these incredible insights that you've shared with us today. I know this virtual audience is going wild with virtual applause. Thank you again. And for the audience, it's time for you to make your way to your next session. Along the way, make sure you accept your connection request and take some time to check out our awesome AI exhibits. Thanks so much, and we'll see you around.
Thank you.